Right. You know, and to pick up on that, where do you think we are now? We're recording here at the end of April. Where do you think we are in terms of the state of play with this virus right now in the United States and globally?
Well, so there's a really good site called COVID. So there's two sites that I look at, right? The first is covidtracking.com and all the sites that use that data. And covidtracking.com is looking at tests, cases, deaths, et cetera. And it's a really good project by Alexis Madrigal and company. And basically, you know, they were just finding that the CDC wasn't able to track tests, so they went and did it themselves. Massive props to them. And that site is, you know, updated very frequently, very labor-intensive effort, and it's pulled by a bunch of other folks. And then if you go to a website called covidcharts.com, basically, you know, you have to wait till the end of the day, but the new cases per day and new deaths. All right, so looking at, you know, April 27th, it does look like it's down, at least as of, you know, this morning or whatever. But, you know, you have to wait a few days to see that. In general, it doesn't look like we have massively decelerated yet. You know, it doesn't seem like the deaths or cases have come down. People are like, oh, it happened in New York City and so on. Well, actually, it's just, you know, it happened in New York City and it came down in New York City, but then it's in 49 other places, right? You know, 49 other states. So I think we're just at the beginning of this thing, unfortunately. And I think that people who think, oh, the pandemic is over, oh, it only happened in New York City, it's going to come to their town, potentially.
And how do you think about the trajectory of the virus right now in the United States, just from a disease impact standpoint?
Yeah, so one thing that so a few things I think are clear, and let me at least give you my worldview on it, because there's some very big variation in people's thinking on this. First is I'm pretty skeptical of the serology work that came out of Stanford and USC and others. I wrote a long Medium post critiquing it, and so did a bunch of other people, because I think the false positive rates of those assays are very high. Why is that important? There's basically been this thesis that, oh, a bunch of people have already gotten it. Because they've already gotten it, it's already spread a lot. That means we're close to the end. We're already at 20% or whatever, you know, 30%, just a little bit more, and we're almost done with this. And the reason I think that's unlikely is it would mean that this virus is way more contagious than other pandemics. You know, like H1N1 or the Spanish flu took, you know, more than a year to get around the world. H1N1 was in the age of modern jet travel. And so this would have to be spreading really fast. And I think that's unlikely. And I also think that those kinds of calculations don't really contend with the second major metric that I think is important, which is this guy, his name is John, I think it's John Burns something from the, John Burns Murdoch from the Financial Times, J. Burn Murdoch, B-U-R-N, not B-U-R-N-S. So that guy has a very useful set of graphs that is something I'd been talking about since March or April, and they took that next level. And they've created graphs of the spike in death rate over the historical average. So the spike in all-cause mortality, okay,
right,
across a dozen countries. And the thing is that, you know, I start from the premise that this is the best test. Unfortunately, COVID-19 has now gotten to the scale that it is a very significant cause of death in more than a dozen countries around the world. Actually, way more than a dozen, but at least a dozen for which we have good data. And because it is at that scale, that means that you can compare it to past years and you can see how many excess deaths there are. And the reason that's important is death is well, from a diagnostic standpoint, I don't mean this in a callous way, but you know, death has high test-retest reliability. It can be diagnosed outside a lab. You don't really have false positives and so on and so forth, right? So lots of the issues that bedevil other kinds of diagnostic tests are not there with death, right? And it's also something where you have probably the best records that you might have. You know, if you talk about, oh, does somebody have pneumonia, right? The diagnosis of pneumonia will probably differ from country to country in terms of how much, you know, like what a doctor would call pneumonia. But death doesn't differ from country to country. So it's the most consistent across space and time. It's easier to diagnose. So it's really the best stat, unfortunately. And those stats are showing just a pileup of bodies. You know, there's a huge surge of mortality in not just Italy, but Spain and a bunch of other countries, including, you know, New York City. And Jay Byrne Murdoch has that. So that's the second set of charts that I look at, the all-cause mortality charts.
This was something that came into sort of the broader consciousness, I think, yesterday, where effectively there were some articles saying that all-cause mortality seemed to suggest that the death rate from COVID was twice as high as was being reported from other diagnostic criteria, which is obviously an enormous gap.
Well, so I was just saying, though, that definitely not to thump my own chest, because this is, you know, but if you look at my Twitter, we've been talking about this since March, and pulling up analyses that were kind of, you know, so there's a guy, Del Analuca, who's doing these analyses in Italy. There's another guy, David Bessier. So kind of tech Twitter or whatever has been kind of digging into this for a while now. And so we had already kind of had the numbers to show that spike in all-cause mortality like a month ago. But great credit to John Byrne Murdoch, because he's taken it next level and actually gone and pulled it for even more countries and gotten the government stats, you know, in a bunch of different places to kind of solidify the analysis. You know, so let's call that, you know, basically just anchoring the severity of the disease. Now, who is it severe for? The short answer is it's very severe for A, old people, and B, meaning like, you know, 65 plus in particular, but as you get older, just risk increases. And B, people with pre-existing conditions, okay? But the second bit is should not be that reassuring, especially to Americans, because they have a pretty high rate of obesity and heart disease and, you know, so on and so forth. It's an amazing, like, number, unfortunately, of Americans who have one or more of those comorbidities. So people who are like, oh, you know, like, that's not me, and they're 53 and overweight, well, they're kind of in a relatively higher risk category. And you can look at the stats on it. It differs from study to study, but the CDC had some numbers on this. And they did a whole demographic workup. The other thing, though, is that it's not that people are immune when they're younger. You know, something like, if I recall correctly, 25% of hospitalizations were for those under 50. So 75% were over 50, but 25% were under 50. And that's not 0%, you know? So there's, you know, like some of the stats, other stats I've seen is something like 13% hospitalization rate for people 18 to 44. And I know people who've had been very sick from it, just kind of qualitative evidence to buttress that, you know? And, you know, by the way, on the topic of anecdote, by the way, people will say, well, the plural of anecdote is not data. And I would agree, except qualitative feedback often allows you to formulate a quantitative hypothesis. Mm. And that's why it's actually super important in tech startups, just to digress for a second, to talk to customers as well as look at your dashboards, because you talk to a customer and they say, oh, I had trouble logging in. Then you put up a new dashboard to see how many people had trouble logging in. You see 1,000 people had trouble logging in. So the quote anecdote led you to collect data.
Right.
So we should never like discount the value of a patient study. That's actually really, really important, because it lets us maybe look at things from an angle we weren't considering and then collect data to see if that observation is real. So point basically being, A, I think it's quite severe. B, it's severe in the elderly and people with pre-existing conditions. C, that doesn't mean the younger people have clean sailing of it. And D, something else I'm concerned about is folks who were so-called asymptomatic. Many of them appear to be not asymptomatic, but pre-symptomatic, meaning that, you know, you do follow up on them and suddenly you're seeing CT scan of their lungs is actually showing evidence of viral damage. Now, you know, they start coughing or they have other kinds of symptoms. And so for at least some people, the virus is like a slow burn, which is bad, right? Because kind of hiding, you know. And so, you know, there's other things where, you know, the sheer number of different kinds of symptoms this thing is causing in folks, we're still kind of getting the table on this. People are reporting strokes. They're reporting weird lesions in the toes. You know, whether this is due to simply just the scale of it causing lots of rare cases, whether it is due to, you know, it actually like mutating and there being different strains during different things, as some people have speculated. We don't really know yet. But I just treat this thing as being fairly severe and not something you want to mess with. And so I think the strategy of like a Singapore or New Zealand is probably right. Okay, I know that was a long answer, but go ahead.
I'm so glad you brought that up. There's, you know, the two sort of things that I was trying to reconcile from yesterday was the report of the, you know, double all-cause mortality based on some of the analyses that we were just discussing. And the second point was there was a study coming out of the state of Ohio, I believe, about testing prisoners showing that 96% of the prisoners they tested were in fact asymptomatic, and trying to reconcile those two propositions: on the one hand, something that would suggest the disease is much worse on the surface than it appears, and then the second,
right,
suggesting the opposite. And it is a very complex problem to get our heads around.
Yeah, and I think my speculation is that those asymptomatic prisoners, many of them will develop symptoms. I tweeted this a little while ago, but in a follow-up study of the different kinds of follow-up studies of the asymptomatics, like 27%, 54% in different studies developed symptoms at some point. Yeah, I think that's what's going to happen with those prisoners, that they're not going to remain asymptomatic indefinitely. Not all, but many of them.